And now we have a very special treat. The Guinness Book of World Records recently awarded the company having the highest sales per foot of any store in the world, the winner, Stu Leonard's. This family-owned business with annual sales of over $400 million has been featured in national media from People magazine to Fortune to CBS News. Fortune named Stu Leonard's one of the top 100 best places to work in America for the last 10 years in a row. Each week, over 100,000 people visit each one of the four Stu Leonard stores. To give you some idea how much 100,000 people look like, well, the Rose Bowl holds 100,000. Tom Peters, author of the best-selling books on excellence, said, "I've searched the world over looking for excellence in every nook and cranny. One of the best examples I've found is Stu Leonard's, and its secret is their philosophy." Here today to share that philosophy with us as a leading member of the Leonard family, please welcome Tom Leonard.
Hi, everybody. Good. You know, I'm thrilled to be here with Rita's, and I'm a big fan of yours. As a matter of fact, I went up to Rita's in October and had a chance to hang out in that test kitchen, and it was pretty hard getting me out of it, to be perfectly honest with you. But this is a big difference, coming to your big meeting and standing up here in front of 600 or 700 people and talking about Stu Leonard's from the very first time I ever asked to talk. It was to our local junior high school in Westport, Connecticut, on career day. I'm sure some of you maybe even have done that in your hometowns. And it was at Bedford Junior High School, and I remember pulling up, and they had a big red shiny fire truck there, and they had jets screaming across the screen, firemen there, and they were packed with kids all around it, and the firemen were showing them their truck, and I walked inside, and I looked inside one of the classrooms, and there was the Air Force showing a movie, and they had jets screaming across the screen, and that was packed, and I walked down a little further, and one of our local clothing stores, Ed Mitchell's, had a fashion show going on, and you couldn't even get in that room. And there at the end of the hallway was Stu Leonard's Dairy, and there were about four or five kids in it. And two of them openly admitted the only reason they were in it is the other ones were full. And one of them was the son of our manager that said if he didn't go, his father was going to kill him when he got home that night. And so I sat down and talked to him for a few minutes, and kind of as a way to say thank you at the end of the talk, I reached in my pocket and I had a couple of free ice cream cone coupons. And I gave them each one of them and thanked them for coming. And I sat on the desk waiting for, you know, maybe I was gonna get lucky and maybe get four or five at the end of it. And the principal came in, Dr. Hightower, and during the break, and he said, "Tom," he said, "I don't know what you said to those four or five kids, but for your next speech, we're gonna have to move you to the auditorium." Now, that taught me two things. Number one, the power of word-of-mouth advertising, but number two is whenever you give a speech, don't take any chances. So everybody here at Rita's is gonna get a coupon to our store for, now it's not gonna do any good with free ice cream cone coupons, but they're good for a coffee. So everybody's getting one at this speech. Now, I was up, when I went up to Philadelphia and had a chance to go up to your headquarters and met Mike and Laura and Jeff and everybody in October. And I went back to Stu Leonard's, and I was telling everybody that I was gonna come to your meeting here and at our manager's meeting. And they said, "You're going to Rita's? And we love Rita's." And I said, "What do you think we could do to show everybody here just how proud that we are to be part of your meeting? So if you drove by Stu Leonard's on our 50-foot high electronic billboard road sign, you would have seen this." There you go. Okay. Now, thank you. Now, don't go getting carried away, Mike, because if you drove by 5 minutes later, that would have been back up there. We love you, but not more than our milk sales up. I promise you that. You know, it's I had a chance to go up to Woodhaven and had a chance to Megan and Madeline and Jeff and Laura and see her first store, and it was very exciting for me, and I learned a lot about it. And boy, you know, you're the experts in what you do. It's you know a lot more about it than I do. And I don't want to stand up here today and be one of those fancy people that starts telling you all about what to do different in your business, because you know a lot more about it than I do, to be perfectly honest with you. What I was hoping to do was share with you this morning what we do at Stu Leonard's and why we think it works. And hopefully what I'd be able to do is spark a good idea in you that you could take home to your businesses and use yourself. And that would really make it worth my while coming here this morning and standing up here, because I'm just like you. I go to work every day in my stores and deal with customers and team members, and I would really make it worthwhile, and hopefully there would be something that you could do. When I got out of school, we had some extra land up in Danbury, Connecticut, and I started a tent up there. We had our store running in Norwalk, and I learned a lot of things. That's kind of how I started. I didn't start in a big store. I started our second store up in Danbury, Connecticut. And this is one of the things that I learned, that we're all in the same business. Whether you're at Rita's or whether you're at Stu Leonard's, we're all in the same business, the improvement business. And how can we do a better job? And at Stu Leonard's, we believe there's four little simple secrets to success. And you'll see kind of in my talk here this morning I put together for you, you'll see, for us, they're real easy for us to remember. The first is the S. It stands for you have to satisfy the customer. Now, here's a picture of our home delivery milk business in the 60s. My dad was a milkman. His dad was a milkman, and there would be a good chance I'd be a milkman if it wasn't for a few things that happened. Here's a picture of our home delivery milk business in the 60s. I don't know if you notice anything different, unusual about our milk trucks. They all had cow's heads on the front of them. And what our slogan was if you'd wave, we'd moo. And the milkman would drive down the street, and the little kids would run out and wave, and he'd press a button, and the cow would go, moo. And if our general manager did a good job, we'd let him take home the company car on the right-hand side there. And business was fun. But something was happening. The supermarkets were moving in, and the home delivery milk business was going out. And my father was having a tough time running this business. And he did a little survey, and he found out three things. The customers loved the quality of the product, but they all had two cars now, and they wanted to go get the product if they could, three, save money. And they were building a new Route 7 superhighway through here, and they were going to knock this business down. He was able to go to the SBA, and he got a loan from the SBA to build a store. And he built a store here, which is in the location of our first store in Norwalk, Connecticut, the original one. And this opened up in 1969. And you could see what he did was he cut out the middleman. Rather than delivering milk home, he built a dairy plant right in the store, and the customers could come in and see the milk being bottled right before their very eyes. And he could cut out the middleman, which was himself, and save the customer money. And they loved that because it was fresher than the supermarkets, and they could come and get it and save money. And right around Christmas, he was, you know, they were bottling eggnog and they were selling it. And a customer came in, and she had a half gallon of eggnog, and she said, "I bought this eggnog and it was sour. I want my money back." And he said, "Sour?" He said, "We sold over 300 of those last week. We didn't get any returns. That's not sour. You're wrong." And she said, "No, it's sour. I'm sure of it." And he said, "Well, let me try it." And he opened it up, and he smelled it. He poured a little bit in a cup, and he said, "Oh, it might be a little spicy, but that's not sour." And he said that she got so mad there were veins popping out of her neck. She said, "I want my money back." And he said, "Okay." And he reached in his pocket. The eggnog cost 99 cents. He gave her a dollar. She didn't even give him the penny change. She stormed out of the store, but she got to the front door and she turned around and she said, "I'm never coming back in this store again," and walked out to her car. And he said, "Wow, I paid the price for a happy customer by giving her money back. But by arguing with her and telling her she was wrong, I lost a customer." How stupid could you be to argue with the customer? Because even if you win the argument, you're going to lose the customer. And he believed it so much that he went out and got a 10,000-pound rock of granite and had it put in the front of our store and had two rules chiseled in it. And here it is. Rule one, the customer is always right. Rule two, if the customer's ever wrong, reread rule one. Now, for you married guys out there, you can easily substitute the word wife. Now, how do you listen? I see you agree with me. Now, how do you listen to the customers? How do you take the pulse of the customer? How do you know what your customers are thinking so you can do what they want? Because we're all in the same business as getting and keeping customers. I mean, I've been in here all morning listening to your executives talk and watching all the slides and everything. I mean, you want to get and keep customers. How do you do that? Listen to the customers. We have suggestion boxes in each of our stores, and we get over 100 suggestions a day from our customers. But I can tell you a secret. It's the secret isn't the fancy suggestion box with the pads on it. The secret is to read the notes and do something right away about it, because the very first thing that a customer is going to do if they write a note in your suggestion box is the next time they come into your Rita's, they're going to look to see if you listened. And if you didn't, if you just look at it and say, we can't do that, and throw it in the garbage can, they're not going to write you a note again. But if you do something about it, they're going to write you a second note and a third note, and that's the way you get people to write you more notes and help you improve your sales and your business. That's the way we get more and more and more notes. So every morning, the box is emptied at 8 o'clock. By 10 o'clock in the morning, the notes are distributed on cafeteria tables, managers' desks, every place in the business for everybody to read. And by 2 o'clock in the afternoon, that same day, we're not interested in whether you read the note. We're interested in whether the customer's idea is inputted into the store, because we want to make sure that that person sees it if they come to the store. Now, when I opened up that tent up in Danbury, the customer came in one day. This is back in 1987. I was up there busy running it, and we had a suggestion box like this up in Danbury. And a customer dropped this note into the suggestion box. It said, "Dear Stu, I've been shopping in your Danbury Farmers Market, and I love it. However, every time I come here, I always see your son Tom working hard, but I never see you. Don't you think he should be on a suggestion box, not you?" Then signed a customer. And so this note went down to the Norwalk store. And, you know, it went around, and I got a call from my dad, and he read me the note. And he said, "You know, Tom, she's got a point. How about coming down to the Norwalk store and letting us take your picture for the suggestion box?" And I said, "Great." And I went down, they took my picture, and I was driving back up to the Danbury store, and I said, "You know, he must have read the note 10 times. He'd never even noticed. The handwriting might have looked a little bit familiar." Too late now. I know he's going to watch this tape too, but he already knows it. But, you know, we're trained at the store that when we see a customer, we don't see this. What we believe is if a customer spends $100 a week in our store, in a year, it's over $5,000, or in 10 years, $50,000. So when we see a customer, we don't see this. We see this with $50,000 stamped on their forehead. So you handle a $50,000 customer a lot different than you handle a $100 customer. We believe our greatest assets aren't on our financial statements. There are customers making a decision whether they want to come back again or not. Same thing with Rita's. You think you have tough customers. We had a customer come back after Thanksgiving, but 10 years ago, and dropped that on her courtesy counter. She said she bought the turkey and she thought it was dry. She wanted her money back. And we were standing there, and Helen gave her money back, and she walked out of the store happy. And a friend of ours, Mike, said, "Guys, please." He said, "How many turkeys did you sell this year?" And we said, "Oh, a few trail loads." He said, "You can't buy a dry turkey. She cooked it too long. You think the customer's always right. I think you just got ripped off for a turkey." And we said, "You know, Mike, you know she cooked it too long. And we know she cooked it too long, but she didn't think she cooked it too long. She thought the turkey was dry." Now, here's my point. It costs 5 times as much to attract a new customer in your Rita's as it costs for you to keep the old customer happy. 5 times as much. What's the cost of a turkey if it costs 5 turkeys to get a new customer in the store? I mean, give her the turkey and let her walk out happy, because we want her to come back. You know, most of the policies at the store, if you think about it, here's another way we kind of look at it. Most businesses set up their policies for, well, let's say the 1% of the customers. A customer comes into the courtesy center and they try to beat you. You know, they come up, here's something, and they try to take advantage of you. So you come up with a policy so you don't let that happen again. But 99% of the customers who really have a problem, they have to put up with that policy now. So what we try to do is run the business for the 99% of the customers, and we get beat for the 1%. We'll take that beating. But we want to make it easy for the 99% of the customers. Now, this is, when I was got out of college, I went to work in the grocery department at the store for a while. And I, you know, everybody uses shaving cream, and Stu Leonard's is about 90% perishable and 10% grocery. So most of the middle of a grocery store, we don't even sell. We only sell perishables, you know, everything you buy around the outside. And we buy the grocery in trailer loads and build big displays and sell it. And a guy came in, he's selling shaving cream. And I said, hey, that'd be a good idea, shaving cream. And I use it, everybody uses it. And so we private labeled it and put it out. And it came in and we put it out. And the first week, we sold 500 cases, big display, Stu Leonard shaving cream, 99 cents a can, and we were all excited. I said, I have a winner. I'm excited. And the second week, it dropped 100 cases. And I said, oh, what happened with that? Because I had a whole trailer in the warehouse. And the third week, it dropped down to 25. And I went, oh boy. And we have a secret, and I realized what had happened. I was used to buying things that people ate, and they ate up right away, and they had to come back and get more. But with the shaving cream, everybody bought 2 or 3 cans, stuck it in their hall closet, and they didn't need it. I had filled the pipeline. So we have this secret weapon that we use at Stu Leonard's, and buy 2, get 1 free. And so I had the art room make this big sign, Stu Leonard shaving cream, 99 cents a can, but buy 2, get 1 free. And I learned the greatest marketing lesson of my entire career. They don't want 1, they don't want 3. It took a year to get rid of the trailer. The profit's the reward for doing a better job for your customers. It's not a game where the customer wins and the business loses, or the business wins and the customer loses. You either both win together or you both lose together. We have focus groups where we bring in 20, 25 of our customers, and we pay them, we give them a 25 gift certificate for staying with us for an hour, and we'll watch their kids if it's necessary. And we sit down and do a little virtual tour around our store and ask them what they think and find out where else they shop and what they think we can do to improve. And we get some of our best ideas from our customers on how to improve. 99% of our best ideas come from our customers. We had one customer stand up, it's kind of a famous story at Stu Leonard's, and says, we don't buy your strawberries because they come in that supermarket package. We want to be able to pick our own, like we do at the farmer's markets. And we said, pick our own? Well, that's a good idea, let's try that. And so we went down to Freddie, our produce manager, and said, hey, rather than wrapping the strawberries like that, let's put them out loose so the customers can pick their own. He said, you can't do that. And we said, why not? He said, because when you're not looking, they're going to start eating them all. And he said, well, let's try it anyway. And so we put them out loose like that. And you know what happened? Our sales tripled because people didn't know how much they were buying. And they started filling up bags of strawberries, and they started growing and growing and growing. And it went, but I will tell you one story. I was walking around the Danbury store one day, and there was a guy over by the strawberries, and he was standing there, he had a little bag of strawberries, but he was eating more than he was buying them. I will tell you that. And Danny, who's my cousin who runs the Danbury store now, he said to me, he said, Tom, he said, that guy's eating his lunch. And he was eating a lot of strawberries. I'll just leave it at that. Okay? Customers are always right. And so I said to him, Danny, I said, that's the 1%. I said, but I'll handle it. And so I went up to the guy and I said to him, excuse me, but I said, I think you got to buy a couple of the strawberries. I don't think you can eat them all like that. And he looked at me and he said, I'll tell you what, why don't you go up in front and read the rug? And so, I said, oh, okay. Now, here's a second little simple secret. It's teamwork to get it done. You know, it's people. Here's our friend Wally Amos. He said, team stands for together everyone accomplishes more. It takes happy people to create happy customers. Okay, you can have the greatest product in the world and the greatest place. You know, it's not easy working in a supermarket, I'm sure it's not easy working in Arita's. But there's a story about this part-time kid working in a food store after school, and he was working in the produce department, and there was this big guy came up to him, and he said, I want to buy half a head of lettuce. And the kid said to him, I'm sorry, sir, but we only sell the whole head of lettuce. And he grabbed him, he picked him off the ground. He said, I said I only wanted to buy half a head of lettuce. And the kid looked at him. He said, well, let me go in the back and ask the manager. I'm sure he'll make an exception. And so the guy said, okay. And the kid walked in the back room and he saw the manager. He said, you won't believe this, but there's some big jerk in the store that wants to buy half a head of lettuce. And just then he saw a shadow and he turned around and he realized this monster followed him in the back, was standing right behind him. And he said, and this fine gentleman wants to buy the other half. Here's Marion, one of our cashiers. And Marion had it up in Danbury. And Marion had an experience where she had somebody come to her register, and she went through, this was just after Christmas, and she had somebody come through a register, and she went through and she got her groceries, and she went through and she said, oh, she said, you won't believe this. She said, I just got back from vacation. And she said, I don't have my wallet with me. I switched pocketbooks real quick. She said, I have to put all the groceries back. And Marion said, well, could you come in tomorrow and pay for it? And she said, sure. She said, but you don't have the power to let me walk out of this store without paying for my groceries, do you? And she said, yes, I do. And she said, well, I'll take the food tonight, but I'm not walking out here without the managers, okay? And she said, sure. And she brought Jim over, the manager. And Jim said, no problem at all. I'm coming tomorrow. And we had a chance to make a customer for life. But I'll let you in on a little secret why Marion did that. Through our orientations, what we encourage is all our team members to think yes. And here's a little thing for you to write down. It just doesn't mean yes helps solve the problem. Look at it this way. The Y stands for look at the customer as if you were the customer. How would you like to get treated? The E stands for do whatever you have to do on the spot to eliminate the problem. What the goal is to have a happy customer. And the S stands for no matter what you do, the manager is guaranteed to support your decision. Now, you won't stick your neck out for a customer and get it chopped off. That's what we, you know, it'll work just as good as the readers too. We promote almost exclusively from within. Here's Pierre, we call it up the ladder, and we're real proud about it too. Here's Pierre, we hang these up all around our store. Here's Pierre. Pierre started at our little animal farm and worked his way up to the head of our kitchens. Here's Wendy, who's worked up through our HR department from a cashier, and she's the head of our Stu Leonard's University now. She's a superstar. But we promote from within. Bill Marriott said, take good care of your people, and your people will take good care of you. This is a picture of my son 20 years ago, but there's a story about this bicycle. Karen went into a store and she went to buy the bicycle, and there were two bicycles for sale. One was a stripped down version and one was this version. And she bought this one that was kind of hopped up a little bit. I think it was $75. And she went to the registers and the cashier rang up the $35 version. And Karen said, $35? She said, I didn't know that this bicycle was on sale. She said, well, it's really not, but she said, it's my special. And she said, you're special, how's that work? And she said, well, she said, just take the bicycle, 35. She said, I'm giving it to you at 35 today. She said, because I'm gonna quit this afternoon. And she said, you're gonna quit? She said, well, the manager yelled at me in front of all my friends today. She said, I've had it here. And so Karen said, wow. Now I just wanna tell you that Bennett Cerf said, MBA, you gotta manage by appreciation. A pat on the back is only a few vertebrae from a kick in the pants, but a mile apart in the results that it brings. In our business, Okay, it's all about people. We only hire 1 out of 20 who apply, but we hire them strictly on attitude. We have a little bit of a waiting list at Stu Leonard's, but we hire them strictly on attitude. We can't do anything with anybody after 16. If they don't like people, if their parents haven't done a good job with them, we can't change that. We haven't done it. We can't do anything with that. We hire them after 16. If they like people, then they're going to fit right in. We can teach them anything if they already like people. But we've got to manage by appreciation and really take good care of them at the store. And it's up to our managers to do that. And that, you know, if we get people who aren't taking good care of them, we've got the wrong people in the wrong seats on the bus. Walt Disney, we're a big fan of Walt Disney, said you can build, dream, and create the greatest place in the world, but it takes people to make that dream come true. And here's a third little simple secret. Excellence makes it better. We're a big fan of Vince Lombardi. Excellence isn't a sometimes thing. We have one idea trips where we can take our vans any place take our little crews to go if we can find somebody who's doing a good idea and try to copy it and bring it back to our store to use. And, you know, we do a lot of demos. I'm sure you do a lot of demos as well as Rita's. We find it triples our sales and a lot of trigger foods. And so we bring our demo crews. We brought them up to Massachusetts one day because we heard of this store that was doing a lot of demos. And so when on our way back, there's three rules to the One Idea Club. First of all, everybody who goes has to get their own good idea. You can't just go and come back. The second thing is it has to be instituted in some form in the store in 72 hours. Can't just sit on your desk because you know how that is. When you get home, you push stuff off. You have to start to get that done. And you have to kind of work as a team on them, you know, with everybody. You can't just, you know, if somebody's having a problem with theirs, try to help them if you can. Well, anyway, on the way back, I sat down and I was talking to Dorothy and I said, what's your good idea? She said, Tom, she said, we use toothpicks in our demos. People throw the toothpicks all over the floors. It makes a mess. She said, I got the greatest idea. And I said, well, what's that? She said, we use pretzel sticks now. She said, they eat the demo, they eat the pretzel sticks and our floors are clean. And, you know, it's the little things like that that really help us out. Frank Perdue was a good friend of our family, and the chairman of one of the largest supermarkets in America, Frank called up and said he wanted to come for a tour of Stu Leonard's. And so my dad said, sure, and Stewie and I and my father went to lunch with Frank and this other guy, and we were sitting there, and about halfway through lunch, as my dad would do, he asked this guy a pointed question. He said, you know, I always wanted to ask somebody who had a whole bunch of supermarkets a question. Why is it you have this whole big line of registers, but only 4 or 5 of them are open, and there's a long line of customers? Why don't you open up more registers? And the guy said, Stu, he said, you can do that type of stuff with 1 or 2 stores. He said, I have over 4,000 stores. He said, I don't have time to worry about the customers that are waiting in line in every store. He said, I have other things to worry about. And my father said, what do you spend all your time worrying about? And he got all excited. He said, you know, from here I'm flying to Miami and we're having a transportation meeting and we're working on standardizing the size of the pallets that we ship in. Now he said, that's not going to make much of a difference to you with 1 or 2 stores, but with us, it's going to save us thousands of dollars in transportation costs over the course of the year. And my father said, wow. And on the way home, he hit me in the ribs in the car and he said, you know, Tom, there's always going to be room for little guys like you and me when the big guys are worried about the size of the pallets and not the customers that are waiting in line in their stores. Now, here's a fourth little simple secret. Wow to make it fun. This is my favorite. If you come to the store, you'll see our dairy plant in the store where you can see your milk coming fresh from the farm every day. We have an animal farm out in front of our stores with over 100 barnyard animals. We believe where the kids want to go, the parents will soon follow. We have country western bands in our stores playing during the holidays. We have Clover the cow and Daisy the duck running around our store. Our audio animatronics in the store. Here's our Farm Fresh 5 that play for the kids. Now here's a customer that made us say wow at the store. Her name is Colleen Blanchard. And that in 1970, she took one of our bags that everybody has here, and she took it to Russia by, you know, She wasn't anything special. She just took one in her suitcase because they didn't take up much space. And she took it to Russia, and she had that picture taken in front of Red Square there and brought it back. And when she had her film developed, she didn't want the picture. So she gave it to my dad, and she said, "Stu, I thought you'd get a kick out of it. Your bag's been all the way to Russia." And my father was real excited. He said, "Wow, thanks, Colleen." So he didn't know what to do with the picture. So he thumbtacked it on the wall in the store with a little note underneath it that said, "Colleen Blanchard visits Russia." And like a week went by. And he walked by the picture, and somebody thumbtacked this up next to it. "The Gardellas go to Cairo." And then we got this one. You know, when word gets out that we give away $3, everybody wants to get into the act. So we started to have fun with this. So we could give away $3 for each picture everybody takes. Here's one. I don't know if you recognize these people. Wait, there he is. We got Jeff in here. There you go. We got Mike. Mike flew down to Richmond. We even got Bob Hope taking a picture with a Stu Leonard bag. Here's our latest one. We got Jerry there. He was shopping up at our Danbury store. Now, here's one you won't believe. This actually came to us from an undertaker up in Danbury, Connecticut. It said, "Dear Mr. Leonard," this is in 87. It said, "I'm a funeral director in Danbury, Connecticut, and I'm writing to tell you of an event which recently happened. An elderly woman passed away, and as one of her last requests, asked that some of her most cherished personal belongings be put inside her casket, inside a Stu Leonard's bag. Her relative stated that your store was her favorite place to shop. I thought you'd like to know that her request had been granted." Now, I don't know about you, but that's what I call a satisfied customer. Today, we've gotten over 15,000 pictures from all around the world. And now here's a picture. I know what you think. But we have a friend of ours, Ron Krivishay, years ago, took a picture of Armstrong and put a bag in his hand and blew it up as big as I am. And we put it up in the store. And my brother was managing the store one night, and there was a guy just standing there like this, staring at this picture. And Stu went up to him and said, "Could I help you?" And he said, "You sure can." He said, "I just don't get it." And my brother said, "What?" He said, "I remembered the moon landing." He said, "I stayed up in front of the TV all night." He said, "Except for one time I had to get up to go to the bathroom." That's when he must have taken the bag out. Now, you know, I'd love, you know, everybody has a bag for a reason now, because what I want to do is, if I could, get everybody to, I want to get a Rita's picture, because I want to get you guys up on the wall. If I could get everybody to just stand up with your bag, I brought a camera with me. Okay, come on, guy, get some music there. Come on, lights up there.
Which you should know about. It holds more than
there we go, you got to get him up. This is perfect. Guy, get some lights up real quick. Perfect.
So come right in, get on in.
Hey, man.
It's green and white and yellow, with a boy and an orange cow. It has a million uses.
One second.
So pick one up right now.
And hold it up real proudly, and wave it like a flag. And shout to everyone inside, it's mine. Stu Leonard's
back. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Now, thank you for doing that. Now, I would love to be able to take everybody here from Rita's. I did a little thing here. I'd love to be able to take everybody here from Rita's back to our stores in Connecticut and show you around. And hopefully you'll come and visit. But I can't. But maybe I could bring the spirit of Stu Leonard's to you.
We could visit the folks in Bethany's Bakery.
important thing in business is to satisfy, and teamwork, what's the way to get it done? But if you want to succeed, it's excellence you need. And wow, to get it done. Satisfy with all your might. Because the Rita's customer is always right. Teamwork, it's the thing you need to work together to succeed. Excellence means every day you've got to strive to find a better way. Now, wow, it's what we want all our customers to say. But if everyone from Rita says wow, you're gonna make my day. All right. Thank you very much, everybody. Thanks for inviting me. Thank you.